In 1 Samuel chapters 4 through 6, we have watched the nation of Israel move further and further away from what God would have from them. They were being led somewhat by a priest by the name of Eli and his sons Hophni and Phinehas, who did not really represent the Lord that well. And in the teachings that we looked at there in chapter 4 and 6, four through six, Israel would take the Ark of the Covenant into battle as a good luck charm as they battled the Philistines. And it would be the case that they would be conquered, they would be defeated by the Philistines, there would be a great slaughter, and the Ark of the Covenant would be captured by the enemy, those Philistines. And when Eli would find out about this, that the Ark of the Covenant was captured, that his sons Hophni and Phinehas had died in battle, he himself would die as well. The Ark of the Covenant would be placed in the temple, the Philistine temple dedicated to Dagon. And over the course of two nights, that pagan stone idol would find itself, by the power of God, broken on its face before the Ark of the Covenant. And so the Philistines would move the Ark of the Covenant out of that temple. And as God would begin to plague the Philistine cities that that Ark was in, as the Philistines moved it around from city to city, before you knew it, almost their whole territory was suffering from plague and pestilence, sickness and death, as they held on to this representation of God's presence among his people, this Ark of the Covenant. And so the Philistines, they came up with a way, a means, a plan, a design to return this Ark of the Covenant to Israel. They do so in the first portion of 1 Samuel chapter 6. And as we pick up our study in verse 17, the Holy Spirit author is Samuel is just recapping and kind of wrapping up and concluding the end of that story. And so he says, "These are the golden tumors which the Philistines returned as a trespass offering to the Lord. One for Ashdod, one for Gaza, one for Ashkelon, one for Gath, one for Ekron. And the golden rats, according to the number of all the cities of the Philistines, belonging to the five lords, both fortified cities and country villages, even as far as the large stone of Abel on which they set the ark of the Lord, which stone remains to this day in the field of Joshua of Beth Shemesh." And so just the recap here is talking about how the idolatrous Philistines returned the Ark of the Covenant to Israel with these golden trespass offerings along with it. And then it talks about here that there's this stone that remains, and the Hebrew would be a little clearer to us, that the stone is remaining there as a witness to these events that have taken place. And then in verse 9, we have a little incident that occurs. The Ark of the Covenant comes back into Israel. And we read in verse 19 that then the Lord struck the men of Beth Shemesh because they had looked into the Ark of the Lord. He struck 50,070 men of the people, and the people lamented because the Lord had struck the people with a great slaughter. The Ark of the Covenant comes back into the territory of Israel, and the men of Beth Shemesh, as this Ark of the Covenant is there in their midst, it's an ark that is not even supposed to be touched by the Levites, although the Levites are the only ones that are allowed to handle it. They're to handle it with poles set through the side of this Ark of the Covenant. That's how holy this ark is. This is how it is to be a representative of God's presence among the people. And yet the men of Beth Shemesh, it would seem, as the ark is there in their midst and it's come back from the Philistines, curiosity takes over. Possibly. Text doesn't say whether it's curiosity or not. But there's certainly a violation of the holiness of the Ark of the Lord. And these men proceed to treat that which God has called holy and that which God has said you are not to touch, and they take a peek. Maybe they take a long look. Whatever they do, they treat that which is holy as a common thing. And it is important for God to once again reestablish for the people of Israel that this Ark of the Covenant is a holy ark. It's not a plaything. It's not a good luck charm. It's not a lucky horseshoe, if you will. It's not a four-leaf clover. It is His representation. It is His mercy seat among His people. And so there's a punishment for violation of His law. Now, the text there says that He struck 50,070 men of the people. We have a little bit of a problem with that because there were probably not even 50,000 men in the town of Beth Shemesh. And it would seem in that some older Hebrew scripts of this particular passage, the word 50,000 is not there, that it is referring to 70 men of their town were killed, and that would be a great slaughter. There are other scholars who look on at this and say that it was 70 men of 50,000 within the community of Israel that lost their life. Whatever the case, you can imagine, for these individuals to lose their life over this violation, that was something that was very hard for God's people to be able to take. And so we read in verse 20, the men of Beth Shemesh said, "Well, who is able to stand before this holy Lord God?" In Psalm 96, verse 9, we read, "O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before Him all the earth." And one of the beautiful things that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ is we have the opportunity to approach, interact with, commune with, have fellowship with a holy and awesome God. That's one of the things back here in the Old Testament. People had to come to God through an intermediary, through a priest. And there were rules and there were laws about what you could touch and what you couldn't touch and what was holy and what was not holy. And God desires that for us, we would worship the beauty of His holiness, not in touching or not touching certain things, but having a holiness in and about our lives and our walk and our relationship with the Lord Jesus. The men continue speaking, and they say, "To whom shall it, the ark, go up from us?" And so they sent messengers to the inhabitants of Kirjath-Jearim, saying, "The Philistines have brought back the ark of the Lord. Come down and take it up with you." Well, then the men of Kirjath-Jearim came and took the ark of the Lord and brought it into the house of Abinadab on the hill. And they consecrated Eleazar his son to keep the ark of the Lord. And so it was that the ark remained in Kirjath-Jearim a long time. It was there 20 years. Ultimately, the ark will stay in Kirjath-Jearim at the house of Abinadab for about 70 years. It will be David the king who will bring the ark from Kirjath-Jearim back into Israel. And we can read that account in 2 Samuel chapter 6. The thing that we need to know is the text will later declare that the house of Abinadab was greatly blessed for having the Ark of the Covenant in it. As his household handled the holy things of God in a holy way and not in a common way, not in a good luck charm way, not in a way of curiosity, but in a way of honoring God's word as to the importance of this ark, God's blessing was poured out on his family. Well, back half of verse 28, all the house of Israel lamented after the Lord. This is interesting. You think this would be related back to the fact of what happened with these men looked in the ark, but this is actually a separate observation totally. What we have going on here is the Ark of the Covenant has come back into Israel. Yay! Only problem? Israel's continuing to worship idols. They're continuing to, well, we'll worship God and we'll worship the Baals, we'll worship the Ashtoreths, we'll continue to hold on to our idol worship while we also have the Ark of the Covenant back. And so they've got the Ark, yes, but living for God? Not so much. A parallel today for us could be this. Oh, it's great. We've started going to church. Yay! But we're living like hell Monday through Saturday. Oh no. Going to church doesn't make a person a Christian. Going to church does nothing for anyone if the heart isn't right, if the desire is not to follow the Lord. Israel, they had the Ark of the Covenant back. That's a great thing. But their hearts were far from God. So what do we do about that? Well, verse 3, Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel saying, notice this word, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtoreths from among you and prepare your hearts for the Lord and serve him only, then, I know the word and is there, but it's an if-then statement, then, and he, God, will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines. What Samuel communicates to the people is you're lamenting after the Lord because you have the Ark of the Covenant back in your possession, but you're continuing to worship your idols, and the Philistines, your enemies, they're continuing to hammer you. Here's what the problem is. If you would put away your idols, if you would honor God, if you would serve him with your whole heart, God will deliver you from your enemies, from the hand of the Philistines. Notice this. Look back at the text with me. Verse 3, notice he says, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, if you'd circle the phrase in your Bible, with all your hearts, circle that phrase in your Bible, with all your hearts, and write this word next to it. Write the word inward. Inward. He says, then put away the foreign gods. Circle that phrase, put away the foreign gods, and write this word, outward. Notice that in the middle of this if-then statement that God's man Samuel is giving to Israel, he's saying within this, there needs to be a repentance about you, Israel, that is first inward. It's got to happen in the heart. It's got to happen in the mind. God, I want you. God, I want to walk with you. God, I want to submit and surrender my life to you. God, I want you to take over. You rule and reign. You're my King of Kings. You're my Lord of Lords. You only want the best for me. I submit and surrender my life to you. It's got to be start inward. But then there has to be an outward action. Put away the foreign gods. See, for each one of us, there's got to be this personal responsibility in our walk with the Lord that says, my heart inwardly, Lord, is directed to you, but outwardly, Lord, my outward? Well, the things I'm about, the things that I do, the things that I have, are these things that honor and glorify you, Lord? Does my heart on the inside match those things that are on the outside about me? Does my dress, does my talk, does my activities, the places I do, go, the things that I acquire, do they reflect what God is doing in my heart? And understand again, please. It's not laying down the law that says, well, because you have a heart toward God, you must do. It's a heart that says, because I love God with all of my heart, soul, mind, and strength, well, on the outward, I don't want to behave in this manner any longer. I don't want to go to this particular place. I don't want to behave in this way because I love Jesus and I want people to see that I love Jesus. Samuel, he lays down here before the children of Israel this if-then statement. You're being persecuted by the world. You're being persecuted by your enemies. But if you would get right with the Lord, persecution would go away. Notice the if-then statement. If you return to the Lord, then he will, it's a promise, he will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines. When I'm walking with Jesus, my enemies are still out there. Those who don't like my Jesus, those who don't like my walk with Jesus, those who this, that, and got an opinion about everything, the world. But they don't touch me. And even if they touch me, they don't touch me. Because I'm in Christ, walking with him. Look at how Israel responds. Verse 4, so the children of Israel put away the Baals and the Ashtoreths, and they served the Lord only. James would write, we studied this past Wednesday night, hopefully you were there for that. He said, James wrote this, therefore submit to God, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. He gives six steps for revival and renewal within an individual or within a church or within a nation or within around the world, James 4, 7 through 9. Samuel, he says to the children of Israel what God has been saying forever to His creation. Put away your sin and your wickedness. Get rid of it. You know, we've talked about it before. Do you know what day garbage day is in your neighborhood? Man, partake freely of it. Take the trash bag through the house, and I'm not going to name a thing because that isn't even helpful. Allow God to show you. Man, what are the things in my house that gotta go? Just as a, you know, kind of a practical illustration. Man, just, they gotta go. Get them out. Put it away. What are the things in my mind and my heart that, man, when I take the trash out, I'll never forget. I won't get into the story because I've gotten into it before, but that day I walked that trash bag to the curb after I got saved. I actually did it twice early on in the first year or two of my salvation. And I'll never forget, man, setting that trash bag down and, you know, and hearing the clink and the jingle and the jangle of the stuff that I had put in there. Yeah, you know what? I may have set a few bottles and a few cans and a few other items in that trash bag on the curb, but as I did that physically and materially, there was something spiritually happening in here that was left in that trash bag on the curb as well. And I got to tell you, man, there was nothing but freedom after that. Nothing but freedom. Hey, Samuel says, hey, put it away. And look at this. They put away the stuff. They threw it out. They cut it off. They got rid of it. It's out of here. And Samuel said, well, hey, you know, you've done that. Well, let's get together and let's repent together and let's call on the Lord together. So that's what happens. Verse 5. Samuel said, gather all Israel to Mizpah and I will pray to the Lord for you. Because, you know, he's a prophet there. He's a judge. He's a deliverer. I'll pray to the Lord for you. So they gathered together at Mizpah, drew water and poured it out before the Lord, an early sign of repentance, that's taking this water and pouring it out. And they fasted that day and said there, and this is ultimately the key in the point of application and understanding of the text right here. They said, we have sinned against the Lord. Please, just do me a favor, and if there's something in your mind or your heart that's resonating with what I'm saying about getting rid of your idols, and you're entertaining the thought in this way to say, you know, I'm going to get rid of my idols, I'm going to get rid of the trash and the filth in my life, and I'm going to do it for my wife, I'm going to do it for my husband, I'm going to do it for my kids. Or, I mean, you know, I'm going to do it for myself. I really want that feeling that Pastor Tom talked about. Would you just please do me a favor? Don't do it at all. There may be some of you recoiling at that. Just don't do it at all. Because here's what's going to happen. If you do it for your wife, your husband, your kids, for you, for your next door neighbor, for your mom and dad, you're just going to get back into it again. And you know what? The next time you get back into it, you're going to go deeper. You're going to go farther. You're going to immerse yourself in the filth even more. Take it from somebody who knows. But when the recognition is in your mind, and watch this, in your heart, I've sinned against God, you'll never go back. When you recognize that the sin, it's not against your spouse, it's not against your kids, it's not against mom and dad, although it may be in some form, ultimately, first and foremost, it's sinning against God. And so they have this incredible heart. They come and they gather with Samuel. They pour out this water. And the declaration of their lips is, we have sinned against the Lord. We recognize. We recognize what we got into. And we recognize, man, what it did in our relationship with God. And Samuel, he judged the children of Israel at Mizpah, verse 7. And now, when the Philistines heard that the children of Israel had gathered together at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. I mean, the only reason the entire nation could be gathering in one location is to muster the troops to do battle against their enemies, the Philistines, right? I mean, that's what the Philistines are thinking. And so they put together their armies and they come up against Israel. And when the children of Israel heard of it, they freaked out. Well, actually, it says they were afraid of the Philistines. You know, they're like, oh my goodness, here we are all together. We were worshiping the Lord. And I don't know about you, but it's not often that I worship the Lord with my six shooter strapped to my side. I don't actually have a six shooter. But this is them. They're there. They're worshiping the Lord. We're sitting ducks. Here come the Philistines. Are ducks kosher? They may not be. Anyway, here we are. The Philistines are coming after us, you know? And so they're afraid. And the children of Israel said to Samuel, do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us, that he, God, may save us from the hand of the Philistines. Ultimately and finally, this is the final conclusion of this thought. Israel now has a correct perspective on God, that God may save us from the Philistines. They have a correct perspective on God following their repentance and their worship. Man, let's be encouraged by that. That as Israel repented, then Israel worshiped. When the battle came to them, they now had the correct perspective to go, God, you need to deliver us from this. If they had not worshiped, if they had not repented, and now the Philistines came, they'd have nothing. That's the time you grab the Ark of the Covenant and go, well, hey, it didn't work the last time, but let's give it a try again. Something's got to work. But see, when we're in the place of repentance, when we have traveled through the glorious opportunities for worship, and don't kid yourself, this morning, that's right there. This is worship. We come together Sunday morning from 9:30 to 1:30, and we come together, it's all worship. And repentance and worship causes us that tomorrow morning when we show up at work and the boss is there and he says, can I see you in my office for a moment? There is no freak out. Because you say, God, I have no idea what's going to happen in there, but I need you to go before me. I've repented. I've worshiped. I'm enjoying you. It's your gig. Well, Samuel, he took a suckling lamb and offered it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. And then Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel. I love this. And the Lord answered him. Yeah. We read, we just blow past it, and I will blow past it right now too. I'm not going to develop it into a point, but I just want us to see that you know, Samuel, he's a man like you and I, except if you're a lady. But you know, just a lover of God like you and I, and walking with the Lord, and he calls out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. Makes sense, of course. And as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel. But the Lord thundered with a loud thunder upon the Philistines that day and so confused them that they were overcome before Israel. There's a lot of things that they don't put in the welcome wagon packet when you move to Florida. I've talked a little bit about it before. You know, they don't tell you that summertime is like one step away from hell, and just because of the heat, and that, you know, when the Everglades burn, you know, that you wake up every morning and you can't, you know, barely see the sun, and your car is covered with ash, and you really can't breathe outside because it's so smoky. But one of the things they also don't tell you either is in the summertime, every day about 3 o'clock, the express comes through. And that express takes the form of a violent thunderstorm. And I'm telling you what, our house, when we lived in Florida, it was built out of cinder blocks, covered with stucco. It was built back in the 60s, and no hurricane had ever touched it. And it just, you know, amazing. But the thunder and the lightning could be so incredible that the concussion from the thunder would just shake that entire concrete house. And before we were in the house, we were in an apartment complex, and the concussion from the thunder, my wife just laughed, because the concussion from the thunder would shake the ground so profusely, the entire parking lot would light up like a Christmas tree as everybody's car alarms went off. It was insane. And there were days I remember, you know, being at church and, you know, the express would start to come through, and it'd get so dark and so black, and the thunder would be so loud. You know, myself and a couple other pastors, we'd stand there at the glass and watch the storm happening, and you'd just be like going, man, maybe this is it, you know? And it was just absolutely intense and nigh unto disorienting. That's nothing compared to this. This is an entire army of battle-hardened Philistines with spears and swords and clubs and chariots. And God don't just move the furniture. God shakes the heavens and earth with his thundering. And I want to note for you, although I have made it a bit more graphic than it is here in the text, maybe I should not have done that, because I love the clear and cleanness of the text that just says, the Lord thundered with a loud thunder. Again, God just supernaturally, naturally defending his people. You know, it's amazing. Why don't we think that God can't lose a piece of paper if it needs to be lost? Why God can't just blind somebody's eyes from just seeing something that, you know, it wouldn't be helpful for them to see? Or why God can't just, you know, do this over here or do that over here? Why don't we, it's here. You know, we can believe that God came in the form of a baby born to a virgin, crucified, resurrected on the third day, ascends to the right hand of the Father, but we come to something like this and we go, yeah, that's a nice story, but I really don't know. I know. God defended his people through thunder. Look at this. The men of Israel went out of Mizpah, and they pursued the Philistines and drove them back as far as below Beth Kar. It's amazing. So not only do the Philistines run, but Israel goes, man, where's my six shooter? And chases after him and takes him out, pushes him back, defeats him. Well, this was such an amazing thing that verse 12, Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen and called its name Ebenezer, saying, thus far the Lord has helped us. Two things I want to draw our attention to here, and you may want to circle them in your Bible, because I promise you this will be one of those things that 3 weeks from now you're going to go, where was that? Where did he get that from? I need to remember that. Circle the two words there, thus far. Thus far. Walking with God and living for God and serving for God is a relationship that is moment by moment, hour by hour, day by day, week by week, month by month. You get the point. There is nothing in our walk and relationship, although he promises to never leave us or forsake us, he promises to bless us and prosper us and give us a good hope, those things are absolutely all true, but none of them are a blank check for us to live as we wish. Walking with God is thus far. Thus far, the Lord has helped us. We can be promised, we can be assured of his help for tomorrow, and he will help us. But thus far, we can see his faithfulness in the past. It's only faith from this point forward. We have his promises. He will help us as we walk with him and as we live for him. He will be there to help us. But thus far, we can look back. And here's the thing, because that leads to my second point. We can, in fact, look back and say, thus far, the Lord has helped me. Remember David, that's one of my favorite verses. I've preached on it before. David there at the end of his life, he would look back, truly, just days away from dying, and he would look back over his entire life, and he would say of the Lord who has redeemed my life from every distress. He's redeemed my life from every distress. Thus far, I can look back, and I can see how he has helped me. And so I ask this question. Do we place these Ebenezer stones in our lives? Can we say about this moment or a particular moment in the past, you know what, thus far, God has helped us. You know what, when we got the news, when we got the word, we thought life was over. We thought it was done. Our plans were ruined. Everything about it was disaster as far as we could see. And then God thundered. God delivered. God did his supernatural thing, and well, thus far, the Lord has helped us. One of the things that's so very sweet about an individual that has walked as a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ for a very long time is as you would talk to them, as you would listen to them, as you would hear their story, you come to recognize that their life is made up of these successive Ebenezer stones, these successive monuments that they have placed. And thus far, God had helped me. And then this happened. Then God had helped me again. And thus far, God helped me to this point as well. And it's one of those things that makes it so sweet to know believers that have been walking with the Lord for a long time. Man, I love Christians of all stripes. It's great. You know, I love the body of Christ. I love you guys. It's like I've said, it's sweet to be back here this morning. But there's something special about those believers. What was that lady's name? 92 in Florida. It started with a J. Ginny Bearden. Started with a G. Sounds like a J. Ginny Bearden. The woman was 92 years old. And in spry, or whatever those words are, like right up to the end. And I could just sit and talk to this lady for the longest time. Because her life, it was one Ebenezer stone after another. Just all the way along. And one of the things that I loved is that she loved me. And she loved my wife. And she just loved to sit and tell her stories. And as she would pray for us, and she knew that for us, and she knew before us, that Florida was just, it was a stopover on the way to something else. And she would just pray for us, and she would tell her stories. And I know that she knew she was just sowing into our lives these Ebenezer stones of faith, these great things that God had done for her, that she wanted to know that her God would do those same things for us. And I hope in some small way that same thing happens in our relationship. The longer I walk with the Lord, and the more you hear, they're not just stupid stories about, Wednesday night I told a whole story about washing dishes in my dishwasher, and I still can't figure out why I told the story. I gotta go back and listen to the teaching, because there was something in my mind that sparked it. But hopefully some of my stories lead us back to these Ebenezer stones of faith. So, verse 13, the Philistines, they were subdued, and they did not come anymore into the territory of Israel, and the hand of the Lord was against the Philistines all the days of Samuel. Then the cities which the Philistines had taken from Israel were restored to Israel from Ekron to Gath, and Israel recovered its territory from the hands of the Philistines. Also, there was peace between Israel and the Amorites. We're close to wrapping up this thought. I ask you to find Joel. If you turn, please, to Joel chapter 2. What we have here is we wind down this portion in this part of the story of Israel's history here. We now have God's man, Samuel, in place. And he's serving and he's leading God's people, with God's people, the children of Israel, following him. And we come to this place where there is now peace from peace with their enemies that are around them. And Israel, having repented, is enjoying the refreshment that comes from walking with the Lord. Notice this, the Philistines, they didn't come into the land of Israel anymore all the days of Samuel. There was peace between Israel and the Philistines and the Amorites. As Israel put away the idols, as they repented, as they had an inward change and an outward change, as they were a people of worship with the Lord, as they allowed Samuel to lead them, as he directed them to God, as everybody's in the place they should be, the people worshiping God and following Samuel, and Samuel leading them in the things of God and pointing them in direction to worship, and God leading his people, everything is the way God would have it to be, to bless and to use his people, and he gives them peace from their enemies all around. But something I want us to see from Joel is how we will get, what you would get there. In Joel chapter 2, verse 25, God is speaking, and he's talking about desiring to bring this refreshment into the lives of the children of Israel. Again, this is a different time when they wandered away from him. But it's so poignant and so applicable to our lives because God says to him, look, here's what I'll do. As there's inward repentance, as there is outward change, as your hearts are inclined toward me, here's what I want to do. I will restore to you, Joel chapter 2, verse 25, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten. The crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust, my great army which I sent among you. I sent the pestilence. I was the one who sent the leanness into you because I wanted your heart. I wanted you. I wanted your life. I wanted to bless you. And here's what I'm going to do. You will eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God who has dealt wondrously with you. Man, I want to be dealt wondrously with by God. And my people shall never be put to shame. Then you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel. I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. And my people shall never be put to shame. It's never too late to turn. And all is never lost when you're dealing with God. Calvary Chapel, Kalamazoo has this little byphrase they use for their church there, that God is the God of second chances. And he is. And third, and fourth, and fifth, and sixth. But you got to turn. You got to turn. And allow his refreshing. Allow his renewal. Allow him to deal wondrously with you. Well, back to Samuel, verse 15 of chapter 7. And Samuel, he judged Israel all the days of his life. He went from year to year on a circuit to Bethel and Gilgal and Mizpah and judged Israel in all those places, verse 17. But he always returned to Ramah, for his home was there. And there he judged Israel, and there he built an altar to the Lord. So overall, in this entire chapter, we have seen repentance, confession, and cleansing, and revival. Ultimately, that's the banner that hangs over this chapter. Repentance from sin, confession of that sin that it is against the Lord God and no one else, a cleansing and a renewal and a refreshing brought by God, and then a revival of a people who would follow God and who would worship him, which is right where God's people are supposed to be, as worship. Now, it came to pass when Samuel was old that he made his sons judges over Israel. This hurts our heart a little bit because we would like to have seen here that when Samuel was old, he sought God and God said to him, hey, your two sons, they'd be great judges. We don't read that. Samuel, maybe thinking some sort of succession, I don't know, we're not told. He picks his two sons to be judges over Israel. And they had a good start. The name of his firstborn was Joel. Joel, it means Jehovah is God. And the name of his second son, Abijah, Jehovah is my father. That's good too. Anyone who, the next person to have a son here, if you want to go with Abijah, that would be awesome. Can you imagine that baby dedication? That's right up there with Faith and Grace and, you know, and Joe and Matt and Rufus and Bill and Susie and Katie and everybody else. You know, you're all wonderful in God's eyes. But anyway, it's a little footnote at the bottom of the teaching there. Don't want to leave anyone out. Then he made his sons judges over Israel. I'm so glad y'all can't hear what goes on in my head. Okay, where are we? Verse 3. But Samuel, his sons, did not walk in his ways. They didn't walk in Samuel's ways. That means they didn't walk in God's ways. They turned aside after dishonest gain, took bribes, and perverted justice. They weren't as bad as Hophni and Phinehas, but they were bad. Well, they were bad enough that, verse 4, all the elders of Israel gathered together. And they came to Samuel at Ramah and said to him, look, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. That's great. I'm so glad they did that. I'm so glad they were open and honest that they came to Samuel. They didn't talk behind his back. They came right to him and said, hey, we got an issue here with your sons. That's a good thing. But what came out of their mouths next? Bad. They say to Samuel, "You're old, your sons don't walk in your ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations." This is a serious problem. Their heart is that they want a king because they want to be like the world. God's people are not supposed to be like the world. God's people are supposed to be different from the world. That's the whole point of them being God's people and governed by God and led by God and living for God, is that they would stand out from the world. How many of us as Christians spend so much time and so much energy trying to fit in when God's doing everything he can on his end to cause us to not fit in? Because he wants people to look on and go, "You don't fit in." And yet I look at your life and it's blessed wondrously by God. What's up with you? And then we get to tell them about Jesus. We have a church here that doesn't fit in. Well, we're not doing most of the things that most churches are doing on most Sundays. In fact, I got to tell you, I'm going 5 minutes longer this morning. I'm going over, so just prepare for it, you know? In most churches, you know, baby dedication, we got to cut it short because, you know, no, we have a baby dedication. We're going to go long. Plus, I've been off for 2 weeks. We're to be different, that the world would look on and they would see our differences and want to know why. They'd want to know about our Jesus and then make their choice from there. They want to be like all the nations. G. Campbell Morgan says this about their request. "This is the revelation of the supreme wrong. Israel had been chosen to be unlike the nations, a people directly governed by God." And that really is the setup for what we're going to see develop. God has fostered this nation to not fit, to be different. And the nation reveals ultimately here in the twilight years of Samuel's life. He'll go on for a ways yet, but they reveal ultimately their heart. We want to be like the world. So verse 6, I like that little word, but the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to judge us." I think that as a dad, the hardest thing to hear would be, "Your sons are corrupt. And you got to do something about that." I think as a dad, that'd be the hardest thing to hear. And yet we see the incredible heart of Samuel. His sons have just been trashed by the elders of Israel. And what is the core of his concern? "You just asked for a king?" What are you doing? That says so much to us about Samuel. Samuel's heart isn't broken over his sons, and maybe it wasn't, it certainly should be, but ultimately the thing that hurt Samuel's heart, the thing that displeased him, was that God's people were, well, ultimately we'll find out, you already know because you've read ahead, that they're rejecting God. And I love what Samuel does. He stands up and he fires all of them. "All of you are done as elders. Forget it, I'm taking over and I'm going to rule and reign and we're going to straighten this thing out." No, he doesn't do that. Back half of verse 6. "So Samuel prayed to the Lord." F.B. Meyer says this about this particular verse. He says, "Things do not always turn out as we had hoped, and we get displeased for our own sakes and God's. We had planned in one direction, but events issued in another, and the results have threatened to become disastrous. There is but one resource. If we allow vexations to eat into our heart, they will corrode and injure it. We must rehearse them before God, spreading the letter before God as Hezekiah did, making requests like Paul, crying like Samuel. Surely it is the mistake of our life that we carry our burdens instead of handing them over, that we worry instead of trusting. And then he says this, that we pray so little. Oh, that God's people would pray. That God's people, that the very next line, when we come up against these types of things, that in our lives, the very next line of the text of our lives would be, so Tom prayed to the Lord. So Joe, so Bill, so Susie, so Jane, they prayed to the Lord. Samuel, what an incredible, what a credible man of God. The elders, the leadership of Israel have just rejected God. They've just slammed him. They've done him wrong. And Samuel, he prays to the Lord, and not about his sons. He prays to the Lord about this issue of the request of a king. And God, of course, in his faithfulness, he always does. The Lord said to Samuel, heed the voice of the people in all that they say to you, for they have not rejected you, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. Jesus would say to us, his disciples, in Mark 6:11, whoever will not receive you nor hear you, when you depart from there, shake off the dust under your feet as a testimony against them. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Jesus would remind us as his disciples that there will be those that will reject our message. There will be those that will, in fact, reject us. But know this, they're not rejecting us. They're rejecting our God. He continues, God does speaking. He says, verse 8, according to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them up out of Egypt, even to this day, with which they have forsaken me and served other gods, so they are doing to you also. In Luke 10:16, Jesus said, he who hears you hears me. And he who rejects you rejects me. And he who rejects me rejects him who sent me. That's Luke 10:16 if you want to look it up on your own later. God continues speaking to Samuel. Now therefore, heed their voice. However, heed their voice. However, you shall solemnly forewarn them and show them the behavior of the king who will reign over them. If you'd like to circle the phrase there, forewarn them, I'd like to ask you to write this in the margin of your Bibles, this word. It's going to surprise you. Grace. If you want to have fun, go home this afternoon and grab your trusty concordance or Bible software program and look up how many times the word grace appears in the Old Testament. I won't tell you. Look it up. You will be shocked. It is exceedingly rare, would be an understatement. And yet grace is all through the Old Testament, and this is grace right here. Remember, grace is getting what you don't deserve. Now, here's what's happened. God's people are rejecting God's leadership. He's given them years of protection for their enemies, peace all around. He's giving them blessing and abundance. He's given them some entire land, and they're coming to Samuel and going, hey, you know what? We want a king to rule over us. And God's going, you know what? It is in their hearts to do this. It is in their wills to do this. They're not going to get it out of their system until they've had the experience of having a king. So you know what? Give them the king, but here's what I want you to do. Forewarn them. Let them know what they're into. Again, please remember the definition of grace is getting what you don't deserve. God is going to give to them. They don't deserve instruction. They don't deserve a warning. They don't deserve information. Not if it was me. I go, okay, you want a king? Go for it. Let me know how that works out for you. In fact, I just got to tell you, I hate that phrase. I don't know, there must be some TV show or something that entered into the lexicon of our community and our nation. How's that working out for you? There's something that's just so hard about that. Or have fun with that. Or, you know, God doesn't do that. He goes, you know, I love my people. They're rejecting me, but I want them to know. I want them to go into this eyes wide open, understanding what they're going to come into, understanding what's going to happen to them. And so God says this to Samuel, and so Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who asked him for a king. So he talks to God. God talks to him, and he comes back to Israel and goes, hey, here's the conversation God and I had, and here's what I'd like you to know. And so Samuel said, this will be the behavior of the king who will reign over you. He will take. Now I want you to notice how many times, I won't stop reading again till the end of the thought, how many times the word take shows up. And I want you to know that the words that are synonymous with this word for take are this: grasp or seize. See, when we hear the word seize, we don't, you know, take, that's kind of like one thing, but seize to me kind of like turns it up a notch, you know, just in the way I think about those words. The king, he will grasp or seize or take your sons and appoint them for his own chariots and to be his horsemen, and some will run before his chariots. He will appoint captains over his thousands and captains over his fifties, will set some to plow his ground and reap his harvest, and some to make his weapons of war and equipment for his chariots. He will take your daughters to be perfumers, cooks, and bakers. He will take the best of your fields, your vineyards, and your olive groves, and give them to his servants. He will take a tenth of your grain. Isn't that amazing? I told you I wouldn't stop, but I'm going to. He will take a tenth of your grain. Tithe means tenth. A king takes 10%. God says, hey, you know what? I'd like it if you'd give me, at a bare minimum, 10%. That would be helpful to you in understanding my economics of how much I can bless you and how I can use you. Now, how I can use your resources. This is a king. A king goes, boom, 10% right off the top. And actually, you know, I look at this right now and I go, wow, if I only had to pay 10% in taxes, that would be glorious. I mean, imagine that presidential candidate. Well, that'd be like a flat tax, wouldn't it? Something like that. Anyway, another discussion for another time that I have no clue about because it involves money and numbers. Okay, verse 16. And he will take your, where were we? Verse 15. He will take a tenth of your grain and your vintage and give it to his officers and servants. And he will take your male servants, your female servants. So he'll not only take your sons and daughters, he'll take your servants, your finest young men and your donkeys and put them to his work. He will take a tenth of your sheep and you will be his servants. And you will cry out in that day because of your king whom you have chosen for yourselves, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. You will take unto yourselves a king. He will be your king. He will be your choice. And you will have to live through it. There are choices that we make that at the point in time after we've made the choice, we recognize that we have made an error. God forgives our error, but there are consequences to the choices that we make, and this is why we so encourage ourselves to be in the Word so we would make wise choices at the beginning. Because God says, you're going to have to live with it. I will not hear you in that day. What he's meaning to say is, you know, he'll always hear them, but I will not hear you in that day of, you know, deliver us from our king. No, you ask for a king, you've got a king, and everything that comes with it. And it's so amazing because this here, what we read here, verses 11 through 18, this is a taking king. A taking king. And what God would have for his people is a giving king. A giving king. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation. He, our giving King, he took the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself, he gave himself, and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross, Philippians 2. We don't serve a taking king. The Lord Jesus Christ, we serve a giving king. And that is the heart of our Father, to give us a king that desires to give us hope, a future, an eternity, a forgiveness of our sins, a life everlasting to be found in him. Well, verse 19, we knew it would go this way. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. No, we're not going to do it. We want a king. And they said, no. And just blows my mind the way the Holy Spirit just records this through Samuel. I mean, the power that's here. I hear my own rebellious voice when I read this. No, but. Not no, but no, but. We will have a king over us. I mean, this is what a defiant child sounds like. This is a child that gets my attention. In not a good way. No, but we will have a king over us, that we also may be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. What? Check this out. Not only are they refusing to change their minds or heed their warnings, they say no to what Samuel is saying. We will have a king. We will be like the world. James chapter 4, verse 4 says that to have a love for the world, to desire to be like the world, is to place yourself in being the enemy of God. James 4, 4. And notice what their hope is for this king. Notice what their desire is for this king that they want. Our king, he will judge us or deliver us. That's what a judge is, a deliverer. Our king, he will deliver us. He will go out before us. He will fight our battles. At the moment they said this, if I had been God, I would have split the heavenlies with a loud clap of thunder that would remind them of 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 10, when God thundered against the Philistines, and they didn't have to do a thing. But you know what? We walk by faith, and we walk not by sight. And it's God's desire that they would remember the Ebenezer stone of how God delivered them in that battle. God delivered them in every battle. I'm not going to clap the thunder again. Remember what I did for you in the past. I will do that for you in the future. But no. They forget the thunder. They forget the God who delivered them, who went before them, who fought their battles on their behalf. Psalm 106, verse 15 says of God in his relationship to Israel in these times of rebellions. And mark this. Psalm 106, 15. We're almost done. We're almost done. He gave them the request. He gave them their request, but sent leanness into their soul. There are not many things I fear in my walk with the Lord Jesus Christ, but one of the things that I do fear and I pay attention to is I never want to be in the place that I'm begging God for something so strong, so powerfully, so fervently, and that it's so for me and not for him that he gives it to me. And it becomes that proverbial albatross hanging from my neck. That he gives me the desire. He gives me my request. But he sends leanness into my soul. Because I'd rather go without. And have my soul filled to the brim with the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Psalm 106, 15. Christian, never find yourself in that place where you're begging God for something so desperately and so dearly, and you're failing to place within that request, God, whatever you will, whatever you would desire, but you are demanding, and you are angry, and you are impulsive, and you are... You're that spoiled child saying, no, but I will have this. Because God may just love you so much that he gives it to you. And the accompanying leanness into your soul, that you'd come out the other side of that, desirous for him and him alone. That's how much he loves us. Well, Samuel, verse 21, conclude here. Samuel heard all the words of the people, and he repeated them in the hearing of the Lord. Samuel's so faithful, you know. God heard it all anyway, but Samuel reports back to his leader, God Almighty. And the Lord said to Samuel, heed their voice and make them a king. Well, let me just finish the thought. And Samuel said to the men of Israel, every man go to his city. There's an irony here that is just absolutely supernaturally surreal. Samuel goes back to God and reports what the people say. And God says to Samuel, you know what? Heed their voice and go ahead and make them a king. Israel is rejecting God's rule. They're rejecting God. But they're so governed by God, they can't even have a king unless God allows it. How amazing is that? I'm so God's kid that I can't do anything apart from him. There's nothing that doesn't come into my life that God hasn't allowed. And so too in this case, they want to reject God. They want to reject his love. They want to reject his provision. They want to reject his care. They want to reject everything about him. And they want a king. But they can't even have a king unless God says, you know what, it's okay. Go ahead and give him a king. And ultimately, we'll see that next week, that God's going to give them a king that fits them to a T. In Hosea chapter 13, verse 9, Hosea says, O Israel, speaking for the Lord, O Israel, you are destroyed, but your help is from me. I will be your king. Where is any other that he may save you in all your cities? And your judges too, whom you said, give me a king and princes. God says, I gave you a king in my anger and took him away in my wrath. I'm your king. I am the Lord of your life. I am your father. I am your protector. I am your great love. This is the God who has said, oh Israel, I've stamped you on the palm of my hand. I will never leave you. I'll never forget you. I'll never forsake you. A mother can forget and leave her newborn suckling child. I will never leave you or forsake you. Well, we're going to go through a turbulent time of Saul. But there's a David, a man after my own heart, on the horizon right behind him. That's for another day, another time, and another scripture. Lord Jesus, thank you for your faithful ministry to us this morning. Thank you, Lord, that where sin abounds, grace abounds so much more. Father, when we refuse, when we reject, when we rebel, you don't let go. You pour out even greater love. You pour out even greater grace. Your mercies are without end. Your loving kindness, it is eternal. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the forgiveness of our sins. Thank you for the life of hope everlasting. And Lord, I don't know if there would be one here today you've drawn to this place who has not surrendered their life to you. In this moment as we pray, may they pray with me right now. Lord God, I admit to you, I'm a sinner. And I believe, Lord Jesus, that you can save me. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I don't understand all the details, but I know I'm a sinner. And I know you're the Savior. And I confess you as my Savior and as my Lord. And I ask you to be my friend, my Savior, my great shepherd forever. I belong to you. Father, thank you for the great work of salvation that you do by your Holy Spirit. Thank you for instructing us and encouraging us and loving on us this morning. And thank you that our worship can continue as we worship you in song and worship you in cookies and coffee Lord, as we worship you in our fellowship time together, brothers and sisters, in the Lord Jesus Christ, in your precious